Arirang Special.
Hello and welcome to this very special program as Arirang TV continues its coverage and analysis of the latest developments on the Korean Peninsula. I'm Moon Gun-young in Seoul. Now, we're less than a month into the new year, and it's only customary this time of the year that we say out with the old and in with the new. But when it comes to North Korean threats, it seems like it's a perpetual cycle that North Korean threats continue here on the Korean Peninsula. So what exactly is running through the mind of Kim Jong-un, and what can we expect from the Kim Jong-un regime and the impact on the Korean Peninsula and the dynamics in Northeast Asian region? We're going to get this discussion rolling.
August 2016, the South Korean government confirms the defection of the highest-ranking North Korean official to the South in nearly two decades. Tae Young-ho, a North Korean diplomat who had made a name for himself on the diplomatic stage representing the North Korean regime. His decade-long contribution in promoting the Kim regime to the West created a significant foothold in Pyongyang's diplomatic strategy in Europe. The North Korean elite is now charting a new path on the other side of the Korean border with a lifelong mission at heart.
Kim Jong-un은 핵 개발 완성 시간표까지 정해놓고 위험천만한 핵 질주의 마지막 직선 주로에 들어섰습니다.
As we start out 2017, amid uncertainties in the Northeast Asian region, continuous nuclear threats from North Korea, and the ever-changing international order, we speak to Tae Young-ho for a rare inside look at the Hermit Kingdom, his exclusive insights on inter-Korean relations and outlook on the state of Northeast Asia, here on Arirang Special.
Now, on this edition of Arirang Special, we're given a rare inside look into the North Korean regime today. That is, we have a very special guest in the studio today. Is former North Korea's Deputy Ambassador to the United Kingdom, Tae Young-ho. He's considered one of, if not the highest ranking North Korean official to defect to the South in two decades. Deputy Ambassador Tae, thank you so much for joining us today.
Nice to meet you.
I have no doubt that you will lead our discussions today in making projections, analyzing and making projections on the dynamics of the Northeast Asian region focused on the Korean Peninsula.
I'll do my best.
Thank you. Now, also in the studio with us to navigate this discussion is, of course, Kim Tae-woo, a former president of the Korea Institute of National Unification and professor at Konyang University. Thank you, Dr. Kim. It's great to see you again.
Yes, thank you very much.
Right. Now, Dr. Kim, my speculation is that this is your first time meeting Deputy Ambassador Tae.
Right.
So did you have any questions for him, or what is your impression of Deputy Ambassador?
Well, at this moment, just I would say welcome to South Korea, and I am really glad to meet you. Actually, I have been very anxious to meet him and share his expertise. I hope we have a very constructive time today with him.
Definitely, and not supplementary, Dr. Kim.
Okay.
All right, Deputy Ambassador Tae, so it's been a couple of months since you came to South Korea. Let me start off with this question. How has it been? How has it been for you and your family? How are you liking South Korea, if you do?
Oh, myself and my family are very busy these days. We are just settling down here, and I'm very busy with the media and also North Korean the policy experts. From time to time, I make a lot of lectures or, you know, the consultations on the issues of North Korea. Yeah.
So my personal question is of your first impression of South Korea. Of course, you're no stranger to Western influence or any kind of capitalism societies because you were posted in London and you've been a career diplomat for North Korea for years. But what struck you as the most surprising for when you got here to South Korea?
Of course, I learned, you know, and studied quite a lot about South Korea. You see, when I was in London, through internet, and I watched a lot of South Korean films and dramas. But after my arrival, you know, at South Korea, I learned that South Korea is more developed, not only in economic terms, but democratically it is very open, you know, and through these recent, you know, political, you know, the developments, I learned that the people are very open and straightforward on mm-hmm. political matters. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I myself have some questions. I really hope your stay in South Korea will be comfortable and happy, but you may have your brothers, sisters, and relatives in North Korea. So will that be okay?
Oh, no. That is the point which actually breaks my heart and, you know, my family's heart very much, because, you know, North Korean regime, you know, always punish and to some extent even, you know, execute the family members and relatives of the defectors. Mm-hmm. So I'm very, really sorry, you know, for my family members and colleagues. But, you know, this kind of the policy of guilty by association by Kim Jong-un regime can only serve to, you know, strengthen my determination to work very hard to bring country's reunification as soon as possible.
As we can imagine, it must have been a very difficult decision for you to take this route and defect to South Korea. What really drove you to actually act on that thought?
Oh, after my arrival here, I was asked, and even, you know, today I've been asked what was the triggering point, you know. It took me quite a long time to prepare, you know, my defection, because quite a long time ago, I started to doubt the North Korean regime, you know, and the system. And also, you know, once you are abroad, you can see the freedom and, you know, the democratic atmosphere of that country. And this kind of, you know, free world usually, you know, brings a lot of the sense of comparativeness among, you know, diplomats and the elites of North Korea. And once you have this kind of, you know, the sensitive of comparativeness, you can easily learn that your life is nothing but a slave, you know, to the system and to Kim Jong-un. So that's why it is very difficult, but on the meanwhile, you have to pretend to be very loyal, you know, to Kim Jong-un's regime. Otherwise, you can't survive mm-hmm. in that system. And all the diplomats, you know, like me, should leave at least one of their children back in Pyongyang. Even, you know, the Kim Jong-un and North Korean regime abuse the love between parents and children for controlling the diplomats who are supposed to be very loyal to the system. But I was very lucky, you know, to take my two sons, you know, here and with my wife, and God helped me, you know, to take my last son from Pyongyang to London mm-hmm. Some time ago. And as soon as my first son arrived at London, I decided that I will not return, you know, to North Korea. And as a father, if I do not cut off this kind of, you know, the chain of slavery at my generation, then in the future when my two sons become a father like me, then they may have, you know, much hatred, you know, on me because, you know, I could provide a freedom mm-hmm. Very easily compared with other defectors. Mm-hmm. So that actually feared me a lot. So finally, you know, I decided to defect in order to give, you see, freedom to my sons. That is, I can say, one of the, you know, triggering point.
I can imagine, you know, so what kind of tribulations and difficulties you passed through. And so in past, the most of the defectors simply did that to solve the starvation problems. But now more increasing number of North Korean elites are coming to South Korea. So you are really symbolic, you know. These people are crossing the border in order to search better life, better quality of life, or the future for their of their children, you know.
Right. It's not just for, you know, to, I guess, resolve their starvation problem, but it's really about the you know, the quality of living, I suppose, that you want to provide your children. And there's a very powerful, I think, parental love there. Mm-hmm. Now, it makes me wonder, with this more exposure of the Western world, and especially for North Korean diplomats and families like yourself, how is the Kim Jong-un regime putting taps on them so that their ideology doesn't, you know, get, I suppose, tainted in North Korean terms by this Western kind of freedom and ideology? Mm-hmm. How do they even plan to keep tabs on these diplomats in the future as well?
Oh, that is a really good question. You know, there are now more than several hundreds of diplomats, and as far as their children are concerned, to my knowledge, there are around 3,000 to 4,000 students of North Korean children abroad, and every day, you know, their life are related to this kind of, you know, the informations about mm-hmm. North Korea through internet. They know all about, you see, South Korea. But, you know, North Korean society can be only maintained by preventing the influx of this kind of outside informations. And Kim Jong-un regime is taking every possible measures to prevent mm-hmm. the influx of outside informations. And in North Korea, whether you can believe it or not, people are just, you know, persecuted due to just one reason that you have seen, South Korean film or drama. So mm-hmm. this is a society where alien idea or, you know, knowledge is not accepted. Mm-hmm. So that's why I can say that, you know, actually yearning for information and idea and freedom is the intrinsic nature of the human being. So mm-hmm. I don't think there is any future, you know, for North Korean regime if they continue to do that.
Right. And which brings me to the next question, and which is all the more reason why the North Korean regime right now, because they obviously know that you have made this defection, they're strongly targeting you. They've called you names and they've specified certain actions against you. What is your assessment of that, and what's your take on it?
Oh, I expected that kind of response, yes, because now I'm using every opportunity to attack Kim Jong-un regime, and also the country's reunification can be only done, you know, by, you see, collapse of Kim Jong-un regime. So this kind of, you see, my activity, I'm sure that will directly, you know, attack, you know, Kim Jong-un regime. So past 50 years of my life, you know, is a kind of, you know, opportunistic life. I pretended, you know, to be loyal to North Korean regime. I really want to be remembered by North Korean people as a hero, you know, who did everything, you know, possible to for the country's reunification. And really, if I contribute in anything possible to liberate my colleagues and people of North Korea from this kind of, you know, slavery system, then I will be very proud of, you know, having or carrying out my mission of coming to South Korea.
Well, I have no doubt that, you know, you will carry on a very meaningful life for the next 50 years at least.
Sure, I'm sure too, yeah.
Yeah, 50 years at least. Now, which brings me to the question, I believe one of the main tasks for the diplomats in North Korea is earning foreign currency. Mm-hmm. And that is what we've been told here in South Korea. Am I correct on that? And do you get pressure as a diplomat from the North Korean regime to somehow gain foreign currency and ship it back?
I belong to professional, you know, the diplomats, but there are also diplomats who are actually not a professional ones, because if it is an embassy, then there are many sections. For instance, there is a chancery, the sections for diplomatic activities. There is a section for commercial activities or military. So usually the big embassies are consisted of these kind of different sections. And as far as my section is concerned, as like me, you know, professional diplomats, we do not have any that kind of, you know, the hard currency, the pressure. Of course, the diplomats who are working commercial sections are different stories, you know. They have a certain, you know, amount of the money be sent to back to Pyongyang, and so they are really, really, you know, pressured. Yes.
I see. You are in lucky cases anyway, right? But
yes.
Your salary getting from the Pyongyang government may not be sufficient enough to support your families. So how did you manage to support your the families?
Oh, a very good question, because my salary was around $900 US. That
per
amount
month.
Of money per month.
Wow.
So that amount of money seems quite little to the South Korean, you know, but actually to North Koreans, it is not a small amount.
Okay.
Because, you know, the embassy, the whole diplomatic, the community should live inside the embassy, not outside. So for instance, you do not have to pay utility bills.
Okay.
You don't pay, you know, phones or, you know, the gasolines or vehicle. The only thing you should pay is your food or clothes or something like that. So actually, with that $900 US, you can actually make ends meet. Yes.
Okay.
Well, it's a little bit difficult for the rest of us to make sense out of, because $900 to sustain a household of four in London, you know, the prices are quite high in London.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit hard for us to imagine that. Now, Deputy Ambassador Tae, you've been a diplomat and you've been working for the North Korean government before 2012. So meaning under the Kim Jong-il administration. And in 2012, we saw this young leader arise to the top, Kim Jong-un. What kind of a difference did you feel, like on the field as a North Korean diplomat under the two regimes?
Oh, at that time, 2012, I was in Pyongyang.
Okay.
Yes, I came to work London in 2013.
Mm-hmm.
So I have, you know, clearly followed, you know, from the first days of appearance of Kim Jong-un until, you know, the now. Before Kim Jong-un was nominated by his father as the, you know, successor to Kim Jong-il, nobody in North Korea knew about him.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody knew his name, you know, and nobody knew whether Kim Jong-il had, you know, this kind of son. He was a totally hidden boy. But when, you know, Kim Jong-il was ill in second half of 2008, he all of a sudden learned that he could not live long. So all of a sudden he decided to start the process of the succession, and he nominated this his younger son Kim Jong-un as the new leader of North Korean society. And people, of course, you know, accepted this nomination naturally, because North Korean people have been brainwashed for a long time.
Right.
You see, that this kind of Kim dynasty should continue for the benefit of the whole North Korean people. So actually there was no doubt on it. And as far as myself is concerned, I was very hopeful, you see, for Kim Jong-un, because I later learned that Kim Jong-un started outside, so he may bring some changes in North Korean society. But later on, my this kind of, you know, sense of hope turned into a frustration and disappointment. First, you know, at first, you know, after a certain period of time, all of a sudden he started to kill high, you know, the officials just for very, you see, strange reasons, just angering him, you know, not due to any political, you know, the reasons. A lot of high-ranking officials were executed without any, you know, the trial, and even the reason of those executions were not properly explained to North Korean society. And later, you know, even
his uncle,
you know, were executed. So he all of started a kind of reign of terror. North Korean society is more than 70 years old, and if a society can only be maintained not by ideology or law, but by the reign of terror, rule of, you know, the terror, then, you know, the people do not trust the society. So now in North Korea, you know, the people, even high-ranking officials, don't have any sense of solidarity between him and the elite.
Right, so he's been in reigning for sixth year now? He's in his sixth year. So 6 years of reigning, whether that be terror or not, how do you assess the stability of his regime at this point?
Oh, it seems, you know, he to some extent, you know, successful, you know, by controlling those high officials by means of terror. But as I've said, you know, the sense of solidarity is no more in among the high ranking, you know, officials. So if you look into North Korean society, the reality of everyday life does not, you know, conforms with the law or ideology, you know, which North Korean regime put forward so far. So there are a lot of contradictions, and Kim Jong-un, even Kim Jong-un himself, is very well aware of this kind of, you know, the feeling and complaint by the normal people. I am not sure whether you have read his this year's New Year's address. In his New Year's address, he said that, you know, he will bring back, you see, the period of his grandfather Kim Il-sung back, you know. In other words, he made a pledge that he will reset the time of North Korea 50 years back, you know. So that is really a clear admission of, you know, the present reality of North Korea and also the mistakes made by his father.
Right, so self-acknowledgement of he and his father's failures, I suppose, because they want to go back to 50 years ago. Very interesting and important that you took note of the New Year's address. We're going to take a look at this short clip of the New Year's address and then continue our discussion.
Now, 충실한 심부름꾼이 될 것을 새해 이 아침에 엄숙히 맹약하는 바입니다.
So there we saw a clip of the New Year's address given by Kim Jong-un himself, and there were a lot of unprecedented moves, unusual moves, terminologies that Kim Jong-un used.
Well, in my interpretation, I think Kim Jong-un gave very clear messages through his New Year speeches. He would do everything to assure internal unity. And his speech included some portion of self-criticism. And also he bowed toward the people and swearing that he would become very good errand boy for the people. You know? But this was unimaginable in past, very unprecedented. So isn't it reflective of the fact that he was disillusioned into the impossibility of making an idol of himself? Or isn't it reflective of his pessimistic outlook of economy?
You know? You know, North Korean society can be only held in place by deification of the leader, mm-hmm. you know. So the leader, you see, of North Korea should be presented to the people like a god. So Kim Il-sung and Kim Jong-il, you know, Kim Jong-un's father did the suit. And when Kim Jong-un came to power, he tried to copy his grandfather, not you know, his father. Mm-hmm. So, you know, his haircut, his you know, walking style, and he tried his best to mix with the ordinary people while killing the high officials on the other side, you know. But he learned that this kind of his, you know, try and approach hasn't worked, you know. Hasn't rooted down to the society, mm-hmm. the people's, he is well aware the people's, you know, complain and North Korean economy, you know, is not improving. So there is a, really a, this kind of complaint of people are rising. So now in his New Year's message, he is now trying to create a kind of new image. So far, he tried to create a kind of image of God. Now, he is trying to create a kind of image of a God which actually, you know, cares about the ordinary life of the people and improvement of the life of the people. So he tried a little bit a kind of a realistic God. Mm-hmm. And also there is a kind of self-criticism, you know, about himself. But actually what he really tried to give to deliver the message to the people that he wants to give people a kind of impression that he is trying his best, you know, mm-hmm. to improve the people's life. But mm-hmm. the reality is not. That is not because of his, you know, lack of, you know, activity, but mm-hmm. this is lack of the loyalty of his, you know, the officials or, you know, corruptions or whatever. So he is trying to turn the people's, you know, complaint towards the high officials of the society. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm very much concerned that this year, 2017, mm-hmm. they may more, you know, the so-called executions of high officials due to this kind of, you know, corruption or whatever. So he is trying to consolidate his power by just killing, you know, the high officials. It's
really sad. Exactly. That point, and I have exactly the same observations, you know.
Yes.
How Kim Jong-un can satisfy the people's economic and welfare needs while inputting enormous amount of money in nuclear weapon making and while suffering from international sanctions?
You're right, you know, the Professor Kim, you know, what North Korea actually needs it's a change of actually the policy. Mm-hmm. The present North Korean economy is not a socialist planned economy. It should be supposed to. Mm-hmm. The present North Korean economy is a kind of hybrid of socialist, you know, planned economy and very primitive capitalist market economy. Mm-hmm. And in order to solve these issues, Kim Jong-un should deliver a new policy to solve current economic, you know, situations. But on the meanwhile, he knows well that if he introduces the market-oriented economic policy, mm-hmm. then there is no place for him to mm-hmm. lead the society as a god. Because, you know, market-oriented economy is very simple because mm-hmm. everything is run on the principle of demand and supply.
Yeah.
And there is no place for the reader to instruct this or that.
Yeah. Yeah.
You see, that's why he knows quite well. If he makes a change, then he may, you see, breaks the foundation, mm-hmm. what his father and his grandfather have laid for him.
Yeah.
So it makes me wonder, does he have a plan? I mean, how does he plan to, or how is he, you know, thinking of narrowing this gap and meeting halfway, if you will, to complement and mediate this gap between a capitalist society and his leadership?
That's why there is no option for him but just rely on Reign of Terror.
Reign of Terror.
Yes.
Right. It also makes me wonder, you know, from South Korea and the rest of the world, we're always wondering whether every time there is a fresh set of sanctions coming out from the UNSC, United Nations Security Council, they declare, we declare that it's the harshest ever, so mm-hmm. unprecedented. So every time it's gotten harsher and harsher, mm-hmm. but there has been no stop to North Korea's nuclear weapons development, so obviously mm-hmm. they haven't worked so far.
Mm-hmm.
Do you, from the perspective of the North Korean regime, like insider, did you feel the sanctions really, you know, biting down on you? What were you feeling?
Oh, yeah, a very good question, because many people have been putting up the similar questions on me. And whenever, you see, I face these kind of questions, I always answer that the effectiveness of the current sanction mm-hmm. Should not be measured by the economic numbers mm-hmm. or the level of the mm-hmm. Management of market of North Korean society. Mm-hmm. Actually, the effectiveness of the current sanctions should be measured by, you see, the change of people's mentality and failure of Kim Jong-un regime. First of all, you know, ordinary general, you know, the public of North Korea know quite well that in order to develop the economy and improve their life, foreign investment are very important, but because of the sanctions, there is no, you know, foreign investment are coming. So actually, you know, the people are losing, you know, a sense of, you know, the hope. Mm-hmm. And on the meanwhile, the current sanction actually pushed Kim Jong-un, you know, to a more tight corner and also make Kim Jong-un's policy failure. For instance, you know, in 2012, when Kim Jong-un came to power, he introduced a policy of expanding special economic zones right. throughout mm-hmm. of the country.
Right. Right.
And he established two important government ministries. One is the State Commission of National Development, and another one was the State Commission of Joint Venture
right.
and Foreign Investment. Yeah. But last year, he dissolved these two, you know, important ministries, because mm-hmm. it is very obvious that mm-hmm. he can't maintain hundreds of civil servants, mm-hmm. you see, while there is no foreign investment. So mm-hmm. we have to measure the effectiveness of the sanction in this way. Of course, the current sanction and even more severe sanction cannot create a kind of economic difficulty which happened in late of 1990s, mm-hmm. you know, at that time. Hundreds of, you know, some people say maybe a million, you see, but actually many people, you see, starved and died, you know, of hunger. But the current sanction cannot create that kind of, you know, economic chaos or difficulty to mm. North Korea anymore. Mm. Because as the sanction develops, the measures to cope these sanctions are also evolving. Mm-hmm. And North Korean people's daily life are developing into kind of format of, you know, the self-management and self-reliance. So there is a kind of, you know, chain of food, you know, are already, you know, established and are being rooted in. Mm. But if the North Korean society are more pushed to that market-oriented, you know, the economy by this kind of sanctions,
mm-hmm.
I think one day, mm-hmm. you know, this kind of economic freedom and the competition would change the sense of ordinary people.
It is not bringing about an immediate nuclear solution, but it can prompt some kind of a changes in the economic system and the mind of people, and then eventually it will bring about the collapse of North Korean system. Another reason why North Korea does not accept immediately the denuclearization demand of international society, that is China. Mm-hmm. China is continuing double play, you know. They're officially joining the UN Security Council sanction, but unofficially support the survivability of North Korean regime.
Of course, we've always been saying that China holds the key in denuclearizing North Korea. Would you agree with that?
And, yeah,
and as a Northern diplomat, what is your, I mean, when you meet your Chinese counterparts in London, for instance, is that the mutual understanding that China is part of the multilateral sanctions, but they're really not on board?
Oh, it is true that if China is really serious on, you know, sanctions against North Korea, then, you know, North Korean's regime will easily, you know, collapse. But the point is that whether China is really, you know, serious on taking up this kind of measures. So for the outside of the world, it's very difficult to read the minds of, you know, Chinese, because on the meanwhile, Chinese, you know, seem to be engaged in sanctions. But on the meanwhile, you know, people come to put up a question whether Chinese are really, you know, against the nuclear, you see, development of North Korea. To my, you know, impression that what China actually is afraid of is that the expansion of American influence, you see, throughout the whole, you know, Korean Peninsula. China does not want, you see, to be bothered with the American troops or, you know, the free and democratic, you know, reunified Korea, because, you know, the recent developments in around China, you know, it is very clear. But on the meanwhile, China cannot, you know, protect, you know, the North Korea with nuclear weapons, because, you know, South Korea and Japan one day may decide to arm themselves with nuclear weapons. And if South Korea and Japan, you know, take the road for, you know, nuclear weapons, then Taiwan will follow the suit. So the most important issue, you know, for Chinese is to prevent, you see, the Taiwan to get, you know, the nuclear weapons. That's why at this moment Chinese has to say that they are against, you see, the nuclear development by North Korea.
And of course, North Korea, I think, is really a double-edged sword for China as well. It's like, you know, the younger brother that makes trouble, but at the same time you need to care for. But so the ultimate question here is, of course, how to stop North Korea's nuclear weapons, right? And, you know, some here in South Korea, some the rest of the world, we have, I think, speculations. You know, we talk about North Korea's nuclear weapons and we talk about the threats, but we don't actually know that North Korea will actually hit the button and, you know, kick off its nuclear bomb. What is your take on that? Is there a possibility?
Oh, I think we have to tell and persuade Chinese first that North Korea's nuclear weapon can one day even, you know, threaten the Chinese, the interest, because, you know, in international geopolitics, there is no any eternal friend or enemy, you know. So even the single truth of North Korea's possession of nuclear weapons can be one day, you know, be a very, you know, big threat to Chinese. So we have to tell the China, and then also we have to convince Chinese that reunification of the Korean Peninsula can be of very beneficial to Chinese as well. We can bring a common, you know, the prosperity, you know, with Chinese and Russians, if Korea is reunified, so we should continue to tell the Chinese. And on the meanwhile, you know, we have to be very careful on Kim Jong-un's plan to be accepted by South Korea and America as a kind of nuclear state. In his New Year's message, Kim Jong-un stated very clearly that last year North Korea succeeded in hydrogen bomb and nuclear warhead. And also he stated that he is in final stage of test firing ICBM. Yeah. So he delivered a clear, a very delicate homework to South Korean government and incoming, you know, Trump administration. So if America and South Korea continue joint military drill, you see, or and so-called hostile policy against North Korea, then Kim Jong-un would continue so-called nuclear deterrent and preemptive strike capability, that is nuclear, you see, test and ICBM test firing. So the level of his speech is actually a blackmailing, you know,
right.
The South Korean and America. But even though he is blackmailing, the new American administration and South Korean government should not accept the his a kind of, you know, the deal, should not compromise on, you see, North Korean nuclear, you see, the issues. Mm-hmm. For instance, now Kim Jong-un wants to make a kind of deal of temporary ban on nuclear tests and ICBM in return for cancellation of joint military drill and easing of sanctions against North Korea. So it seems very fine if his offer and even some American experts, you know, agreed on this kind of approach. But if America and South Korea government accept this kind of compromise or deal, then it only serves to justify so far, you see, the stance of North Korean regime. So far, North Korean regime told the world community that North Korea was pushed by South Korea and America to develop nuclear weapons because of this kind of military exercise, blah, blah, of all these things. So once America and South Korea decide to do that in return for that, then the world community may have that kind of sense of, oh, America and South Koreans had some responsibility of creating this kind of nuclear crisis. And secondly, if this kind of, you know, deal or compromise is reached, then internationally it accept the present, the North Koreans' nuclear address, you know. So it may also justify in legally the present current state of North Korea. That is what really Kim Jong-un wants to do. So American new administration and South Korean government should not be deceived by this kind of, you know, tactics.
Right, so any kind of a compromise would give off the wrong signal to the rest of the world that legitimizes North Korea's claims of having a nuclear weapon.
Sure.
I think that's what you're saying. There are so many implications, and this intertwining of the military technology, diplomacy, economic sanctions, social impact, all this in order to basically rein in North Korea and its nuclear weapons program. But of course, there is that certain aspect of the international world cooperating with one another vis-a-vis North Korea, at the same time bilaterally. So South Korea, North Korea, and of course North Korea, the U.S. Now with this new administration in the United States, Donald Trump, U.S. President Donald Trump, is, to me personally, I think he's unlike any other leaders U.S. has had. Of course, on Twitter, he, Donald Trump was very strong about his opposition against North Korea's nuclear bombs. What is your outlook on Pyongyang's foreign policy vis-a-vis the new administration in the U.S.?
If we look back the history of North Korean diplomacy, North Korea so far has been very negative to American Republican Party. So far, there were many, you know, the dialogues between North Korea and America, and there were under table, you know, discussions. There were many channels of, you know, the meetings. But these kind of, or majority of this kind of activity were done between North Korea and American Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. Those high-ranking officials who ever visited North Korea so far are all from Democratic, you know, the party, like former U.S. President, you see, the Clinton, and also, you see, Madame Albright. Mm-hmm. They are all from Democratic Party. And so far, American Republicans are very, you know, have been very negative. Mm-hmm. They are very hardline. Mm-hmm. And to my impression, these days, most of the president-elect Trump's, you know, the security and diplomatic lines are consisted of these kind mm-hmm. of, you know, hardliners. So I can feel that the future Obama...
You mean Trump's, Donald Trump?
Yeah, sorry, Trump's, yes, Trump's, you know, mm-hmm. Policy would be more, you know, near hardline rather than, you know, the soft.
My, finally, we would like to know, so we've all, I think, decided and agreed upon the idea that China holds the key in actually convincing, persuading North Korea to abandon its nuclear weapons. What is it going to take for us to do to convince China to really get on this bandwagon and, you know, really be on board with us in denuclearizing North Korea?
I think we have to take the reality that the Chinese peoples of the way of thinking is also changing because of the internet and, you know, of all these things. So now this kind, the present North Korean, the policy by Chinese authority is kind of, you know, a policy from top to the down, very totalitarian, you know, the policy. Mm-hmm. But if the general, the public, you know, opinion by Chinese people for North Korea is more sympathetic on the sufferings of North Korean people, you know, then I think one day, you know, Chinese government may, you know, the take to proper, you know, the policy on North Korea. So I think I'm quite sure that time is on our side. There is no more any Kim family member after Kim Jong-un. When Kim Jong-un, you see, goes out, then I can say that reunification will come.
Okay.
Now, I mean, we are aware that Kim Jong-il had other sons, like you mentioned, and the one that comes to my mind particularly is Kim Jong-chul, because I know that you personally accompanied him once or twice while he was overseas. What kind of, like, give us an inside look into what his personality is like and if there's any likeliness of an alternative to Kim Jong-un.
Mm-hmm. Yes, many people asked me, you see, whether Kim Jong-chul is number two mm-hmm. in North Korean society. North Korean society, as I've told you, is a society there is only, you know, one leader. There cannot be any, you know, number two or number three, you know. Mm-hmm. And even though Kim Jong-chul is his, Kim Jong-un's brother, mm-hmm. he is not number two. That is my the answer. And I learned that Kim Jong-chul is not interested in politics at all. He's only interested in music. If he is born from normal family, you know, he is really, you know, gifted and talented in playing, you
oh,
know,
really?
Mm. The guitar. He is a really, you know, a good guitarist, yes. So he is only interested in music, not in politics.
Isn't he simply stay very low profile because he's aware that his life can be in danger if he tries to get closer to political power?
To my impression, he doesn't envy, you know, his brother. And also, he is a little bit, you know, ill.
So
yes.
You should be right. Yeah.
Yes.
Once Kim Jong-un is out of his office, that means a collapse of the North Korean regime. Is it safe to say?
That's right. Now, all North Korean people and, you see, high-ranking officials know quite well that the current hereditary system has nothing to do, you see, with true communism. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is not the society, the people and the previous generations dreamed of. the Kim family only built a society and country which only, you know, serves only for Kim family. So now people in North Korea know this very well. So no further future for Kim family. That is what I'm absolutely sure.
How many years do you see until this reunification?
When I arrived at South Korea, you know, I learned that many people do not have any hope for reunification, you know, and the recent, you know, the poll shows that only 63-67% of general public support the reunification. One of this kind of rate is because the people think that reunification in a way of very, you know, far distance. But my personal determination is to try every, you know, the possibility to reunify the country in 5 years.
In five years. Well, that's, you know, that's fair enough. In my lifetime, in all of your lifetime, so that's fair enough, right?
Well, Ambassador Tae, let's try together.
Yes, thank you.
Oh, definitely so. Now, I think, Deputy Ambassador Tae, this is your first debut to Arirang TV's viewers. Do you have a message to them that you would really like to touch their hearts about?
I'd like to tell all Arirang viewers, not only, you know, overseas Korean or, you know, foreigners, that, you know, the Korean reunification is not only the matter for, you see, Korean people, but this is the matter for common prosperity of whole Northeast Asia. So please join us together to reunify the country as soon as possible.
And I think you've made yourself very clear on that front that you are an advocate of this reunification, and we'd like to show you our respect on various levels, from parental love to patriotism, I suppose, to the Korean Peninsula, to One Korea, and for being here with us today and for this very constructive discussion today.
Thank you. You've done your job well.
Yes, thank you. And of course, I cannot thank enough our Dr. Kim Tae-woo.
Really enjoyed being with you and with you.
And the same goes for you. And of course, thank you to our viewers for staying with us throughout this discussions. And we hope to have more of these soon. But this is a closing for now. And bye-bye for now.